Good morning, all of you. Welcome back to the next class of history. We had only one history class, my dears, doesn't matter. And we will be discussing the further topics from the chapter Delhi Sultanate. Okay. So I'm sure that you all could understand the rulers of Delhi Sultanate. So let me tell you one matter. The sultans means the rulers who had come away from India and they set over Delhi. As a result of them, they were called as Delhi Sultanates. Understood? So why we are calling sultans as Delhi Sultanate or Delhi Sultans? It's simple, because they came from away from our country. Out of our country they came and they set over Delhi. That's why they were called as Delhi Sultans. Okay, see, Delhi was one of the region which was used by most of the foreigners who had come over our nation for setting their administrative center. Almost all rulers who came away from our country and they targeted to control our nation, and all of their administrative ideologies and administrative institutions and everything they set over Delhi. So Delhi has its own importance. Even now also it has its own importance, right? See, we are going to learn the first paragraph of the chapter. First paragraph of the chapter I have reduced into 2 points. One is Tomara, 12th century Chauhan and Delhi Wala. Okay. So before the arrival of Delhi Sultans, before the arrival of Sultans or slave dynasty over India, or especially over Delhi, it was controlled by Tomara Rajputs. Delhi was actually under the control of Tomara Rajput before the arrival of slave dynasty. Who set this slave dynasty? Who set it? The slave master. Who was that, the first one? Qutbuddin Aibak. Qutbuddin Aibak, before his arrival over Delhi, Delhi was controlled by Tomara Rajput. So Tomara Rajputs were the people who ruled over Delhi till 12th century. Delhi was ruled by Tomara Rajputs. Okay. And then 12th century, the Delhi was captured by Chauhan or Chamannas. Who captured? Chauhans or Chamannas were captured Delhi from Tomara Rajputs. From Chauhan, when Chamanna or Chauhan, so Chauhan dynasty were otherwise called as Chamanna dynasty too. There were many rich people in Delhi and their life was superior over Delhi during the time of Tomara Rajput, Chauhan kingdom or Chamanna kingdom, and they made their own artificial materials and things and buildings over Delhi, and they given a name for that place. It was Delhi Wall. What is it? Delhi Wall. Okay, so the history of the Delhi we are learning right now. History, Delhi was under the control of Tomara till 12th century. From the Tomara, it was captured by Chauhan or Chamannas, and they had set Delhi as an administrative place, as an administrative place. All the regions cannot be set as an administrative place. So Delhi took much time to make as an administrative town or administrative city. Okay, there were many cities, there were many buildings, and all these were created in Delhi gradually. Okay, gradually all these developments had taken place in Delhi. This is what in the first paragraph means. Okay, then paragraph number two, there the major thing is transformation of old Delhi into an administrative center. Okay. Delhi was used by the earlier rulers. They used it as a capital city for their administration, no doubt. But Delhi has made as a pure administrative center by the slave dynasty. Or the sultans had transformed the Delhi's culture into another level. by sultans. Sultans. Okay. Sultans were the people who came away from our country, from West Asia. From Arabian countries, they had reached into India. And when they came over Delhi, they unified Delhi in under their control. And they had given a strong foundation over Delhi for making it as an administrative town. So that is what in the second paragraph. So second paragraph is telling us that Delhi had transformed into a better capital town or city by the Delhi Sultans or the slave dynasty. So Delhi Sultanate we discussed. Under Delhi Sultanate, five kingdoms are there. The first kingdom which came over Delhi and transformed Delhi into a better level, that was the slave dynasty. That was the slave dynasty. Is it clear? Before slave dynasty, it was under Tomara. Then 12th century, it was transformed by Chauhan. And there were some kind of administrative institutions over Delhi. Complete change which was taken place over Delhi to make it as a proper, valuable administrative city by the sultans. This is what in the second paragraph, first and second paragraph mean for this. Okay, now we are moving to another side of the chapter. Finding about Delhi sultans. How do you know about me? I think you might have seen me, right? And I know very well about you too. Because we too are living in a same period, so that we can understand how is he. When you when you imagine Prashant sir, first thing that you are remembering in your mind, yes, Prashant sir, he is making such a loud sound on the veranda, right? He is always running behind the children and giving some kind of scolding and beating and all those things. And a person with a beard. Got it? A person with beard. When you imagine about me, you can have a clear picture about me by all these examples. Right? Okay, it's okay. And I can also recognize you because you ran on the veranda for a long time and you fall down and I have given one nice chocolate to you. I can also remember you. Because we two groups are living in the same period. Okay. So why this person is telling these kind of example? Is this example is there in the Delhi Sultanate? No, it's not there. I'm telling you this example for understanding a matter. How do you know about Delhi Sultanate? How do you know about the Iltutmish? How do you know about Rasiya Sultana? How do you know about Ghiyasuddin Balban? How do you know about the slave dynasty's former? How do you know about Tomara Kingdom? How do you know about Chauhan Kingdom or Chamanna Kingdom? History. Right? We are collecting the data of the past time and learning it and understanding, yes, this group of people were lived there. So now we are going to learn a group of kingdom which was prevailed over Delhi many years back. How will you get information about the Delhi Sultanate? If you go in Delhi right now, you won't be getting precise information about it. You will be getting only corona if you go to there. Right? See, you have to recognize. Now we are going to learn about the Delhi Sultans and their findings. How can we understand? How can we recognize more about the Delhi Sultans? I will tell you what are the ways we can understand about the Delhi Sultanate. Are you ready? Look at here. Paragraph number 1 under finding about Delhi Sultans. Okay. First one, inscriptions, coins, and architecture. Inscriptions, coins, and architecture. We can easily have informations about a kingdom or a dynasty or an empire by using the historical materials like inscriptions, coins, and architecture. What is inscription? Inscription means writings on the roofs, writings on the walls, writings on the rocks, writings on the palm leaves. This is inscription. Where do you write the notes? What I am going to give you? Notebooks. The notes which I am going to give you, if I suggest you to write on the wall of your home, you won't be writing. Am I right? Take a big marker and write Delhi Sultanate on the board, and the first ruler, second ruler, third ruler, fourth ruler, then you will become a history. Why? Your parents will not keep you alive if you are writing on the wall. Then what is inscription? During that time, people were writing their matters on the walls, on the roofs, on the rocks and the palm leaves. This is what inscription. They had no notebooks. They had no slates. They had no computers to store their information. But when they had a war with one enemy, if they could win, they wrote everything on the wall. They wrote everything on the roofs. They wrote everything on the pillars of their palaces and on the palm leaves and all. Okay, then what is coins? Let us have a look at that. Right now we discussed inscriptions. Inscriptions means the informations which are related to the rulers or those period. They had written on the walls, roofs and pillars of the walls, pillars of their palaces, right? This is called inscription. So the people who lived far years back, if they have written all these kind of things on the walls and roofs and pillars or rocks, the present day's historians can read it and understand what does they mean for that, right? So inscription is the way to get information related to the Delhi Sultans. That's it. Another one is coins. They had used coins for economic transactions. So at present you can see that the Indian coins, you can take on that 1 rupees coin, 2 rupees coin, 10 rupees coin, then like that you can see. On that coin you can see that Indian rupee will be written over there. Then some pictures will be stamping on the top of it, right? So after hundreds of years, if Indian people will be there, people of India will be living, then their next generation will be there in our country for after few years also. When they are learning about their past, they will be getting the 1 rupees coin what we have used at present. The same manner, Delhi Sultans, they used coins, and that coins also gave lot of informations related to the Delhi Sultans. They used gold coins, they used silver coins, and these all coins gave much information related to their life. If coins could be found from the Delhi Sultanate region, what information can you understand? What information that you can deliver from the coin? Yes, they had used coins for economic transaction. Coins will not be boiled in a vessel and having it as a food, right? Coins will be used for purchasing the materials and exchanging the commodities each other. So coins will help us to understand a lot of things about the Delhi Sultanates. Inscription which help us a lot to understand about the Delhi Sultanate. And architecture also will help. Architecture, the greatest architecture, let me tell you the matter. Qutb Minar, you might have heard. Even now, even in this moment, this Qutb Minar is being present. It was constructed by Qutb Uddin Aibak. It was started by Qutb Uddin Aibak and its functioning and its completion was held during the time of Iltutmish. Okay. So that is a historical monument architecture. Qutb Minar is a physical material, a building it is, a historical monument it is. By looking at that, we can understand that whatever skills that people had. At present, we have a lot of technologies to create such an impressive buildings. But at that time, especially in the 12th century, you imagine those people could make such an impressive building like Qutb Minar. They made beautiful mosques and they had no technologies, my dears. They used all these, their technology, their idea, their skills, their abilities, everything can be recognized by using their architecture. So those people's life, those people's skills, what material they had used for making all these kind of things and what instrument they had used to lift all these things in such an height. These all can be easily identified by us right now by using these all kind of material. Inscriptions, coins and architecture helps us to understand about Delhi Sultanate. Hope it is clear to you. Clear? The next is Tariq and Tawarik. Tariq means singular. Tawarik means plural. Simple. Okay. Singular and plural. When you hear, oh my God, what will be the next? Doesn't matter. Tariqs and Tawariks are the books written in Persian language about the Delhi Sultanate. Many writers were there. These writers had written certain books. They were called, if a writer who wrote about a single ruler of Delhi Sultanate, a book, which is been called Tariq. If I am a writer, I am going to write about one ruler of Delhi Sultanate and I concluded that work, that is Tawarik. Another writer, who is writing about three or four books related to four rulers of Delhi Sultanate, that is called Tawarik, singular and plural. If a person who wrote one book related to the Delhi Sultanate, that is Tariq. If a person who wrote more than two books related to the Delhi Sultanate can be called as Tawarik. Clear? Tariq and Tawarik. What kind of information is written in this Tariq and Tawarik? That is my question. My question is to you is, authors were there or writers were there, they wrote some books. A writer who wrote one book called Tariq and writer who wrote more books related to the principles of a ruler of Delhi Sultanate can be called as Tawariks. Okay. See, Tariq and Tawarik, the writers that they always try to include the advices to the rulers. Advices, rulers wanted lot of advices. And these advices were included. The advices means these writers of Tariq and Tawarik, they mainly lived in cities. They hardly lived in villages, which means most of the Tariq and Tawarik writers were lived in Delhi or in city. Only when people lived along with the rulers, they can understand about the character of the ruler. They can understand about the negatives of the ruler. They can understand about what area that ruler has to be improved. Am I right? So this Tariq and Tawarik writers were writing about the Delhi Sultans. They lived in the cities. Only when they live in the city, they can understand about these rulers. They can understand about these rulers and their characters and their skills, abilities and weakness and everything. Okay. So where did this Tariq and Tawarik others were lived in? Lived in cities and hardly in villages. And what is Tariq and Tawarik? Tariq means singular. Tawarik means plural, which means Tariq is a writer who wrote about a ruler of Delhi Sultanate. One book can be called as Tariq. Two books, Tawarik, plural. Okay, see, this Tariq and Tawarik included advices, which means the authors through their books, they were advising the ruler, my dear lord or my lord, you please do this for the people. My lord, you please don't do this for the people. Advices, instructions, directions, strategies, plans were given by these Tariq and Tawarik writers to the masters or to the rulers. Is it clear? Then, expecting rewards. Why did this Tariq and Tawarik works were held in Delhi? Tariq and Tawarik are giving us lot of informations about the Delhi Sultanate. That are the historical material. That historical material can be easily used by us and can understand about the living standards of Delhi Sultans. And what were the difficulties faced by the people who were lived under the Delhi Sultan can easily be identified by using these historical books. Which historical books? Tariq and Tawarik. See, my dears, the Tariq and Tawarik writers, you know, they wrote their works or wrote these advices to the rulers only for expecting something into their pockets. Only expecting something into their pockets. If I am doing a work, I am expecting something to my pocket. Is it? Everybody are doing works for getting something in their pocket. For example, if I am telling you these all matters to you, when I am telling these matters to you, dears, if I am giving you a false information, and of course the people who are watching this, they will be criticizing me, and the authority who is appointing me for this duty will be sending away and I won't be getting the income. So I have to satisfy everyone. Only then I will be getting something in my pocket. I have to satisfy. So Tariq and Tawarik writers, you know, they wrote these books about the rulers. Okay. They wrote the books about these rulers expecting money. Then let me ask you one question. How will these rulers give money to these Tariq and Tawarik writers? How will they give money? If the Tariq writer who is writing complete negative about the rulers, that ruler is not going to give anything for that writers. That ruler will kill that writer, right? Tariq ruler, Tawarik rulers, they never wrote about the negative side of the masters or the Delhi Sultans. They wrote only about the positive side of the rulers. This ruler is good. He is kind. When the ruler is reading this, he will be understanding. Oh, this writer is doing this. Okay. Then let us see the next. Ready? See, Tariq and Tawarik writers, they always tried to satisfy the people, which means the rulers. If a ruler, when will be a ruler happy with the writers? When the writers are writing the matters positively about them, then they will be giving certain rewards or gifts or tributes to the Tariq and Tawarik writers. Okay, so let me remind you one more thing. The thing is, Tariq and Tawarik writers, they mainly done their activities of writing to get financial upliftment. So they never wrote about the negative sides of the ruler. If the negative sides are being written by a ruler, sorry, or a writer, he or she will not be getting any support by from these rulers. So every Tariq and Tawarikh writers decided to write about the positive sides of the masters or the rulers, my dears. Okay. So here, they had supported a matter, it was birthright and gender distinction. So at that time, the society had a system. The system was, a person who take birth in a rich family or a child who take birth in a rich family, that child will be getting more social support. Ah, yes, that child is from that family. That family is rich. Okay. A child who have taken birth in a poor family, nobody is going to mind that child. Social privileges, social respects were received by the children or received by the people by birth. It was decided by the rulers. That was actually should not be practiced. A person should not be discriminated on the basis of their income. A person should not be discriminated on the basis of their gender quality. A person should not be created into the disparity group by considering their color. A person should not be discriminated or removed away from the society based on the dress what they have worn. But Delhi Sultans, they had clearly made a discrimination over women. Men were having rights, women were not having rights, rich were having rights, poor were not having rights. This was the negative side of the rulers of Delhi Sultans, but it was not questioned by any of these Tariq and Tawarikh writers. Why these Tariq and Tawarikh writers were not questioned, these masters, that you are not giving equal respect for women, that you are not giving social privileges equally for everyone? Why don't you give these kind of respect to each and every categories? They never questioned why they did not question these masters. The answer is very simple. If any Tariq and Tawarikh writer who criticized the master or the ruler, his work, his life will be under threat. That is why. Okay. So this is the topic. This is the small area we have discussed. Within one more class, we will be able to finish the topic. So let me tell you one thing. It is page number, from the beginning of our third chapter to till page number 33, you have to read the lesson very nicely with your textbook, open the dictionary and find the unfamiliar word, underline in the textbook and write the word meaning of that on the top of it and read it very carefully. So now you have reached in 7th standard and I am your SS teacher. I am not going to give you any answer. Answer you will be preparing by yourself and I will make you capable for making question answers. And when you comes to the 8th standard and 9th standard, you would be sufficient and you will be self-sufficient for making the answers. I'm sure that. So read the textbook clearly without leaving any simple box from that and find doubts. Take it as a challenge. Find doubts, call me and clarify it. Okay. So we are concluding today's class with these targets, with these topics. So read carefully. I'm requesting you to read this textbook very clearly. Okay. So that you will be capable enough to answer whatever questions. So I will be giving questions to you. You will be answering the questions and you will be sending to me. But when the exam comes, The questions what I asked you will not be there in the question paper. Another way of questions. Content will be same, but the way of questions will be different. So that when you read the textbook, whatever tested question have been asked by me or board, you will be capable enough to answer the question. I have to make you in that level. You will come up to that level, I'm sure. Okay, so I'm concluding today's class. So these are the things we learned today. Read very nicely. Okay, we will be meeting in the next history class. Thank you so much for having such a patient listening for my class. Thank you. Thanks a lot.